Well, good morning. Good to see everyone today. And of course, to all the fathers out there, happy Father's Day. We're now in purple. So the season of Pentecost, which is pretty much green. Did I say green? Purple. Okay. Yeah, it's green. So we're green as everything else is green up here. Let's just go ahead and dive into our opening hymn, Christ the Eternal Lord, hymn number 829. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We pause to privately confess specific shortcomings to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. Rejoice, for your sins are completely forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you good things that surpass our understanding. Cast out all sins and evil desires from us, and pour into our hearts your Holy Spirit to guide us into all blessedness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may now be seated for the Old Testament lesson.
Our Old Testament reading is found in Isaiah chapter 65, verses 1 through 9. I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me. I was found by those who did not seek me. To a nation that did not call on my name, I said, "Here am I, here am I." All day long, I have held out my hands to an obstinate people who walk in ways not good, pursuing their own imaginations, a people who continually provoke me to my very face, offering sacrifices in gardens and burning incense on altars of brick, who sit among the graves and spend their nights keeping secret vigil, who eat the flesh of pigs and whose pots hold broth of unclean meat, who say, keep away, don't come near me, for I am too scared for you. Oh no, sacred for you. Such people are smoke in my nostrils, a fire that keeps burning all day. See, it stands written before me. I will not keep silent, but will pay back in full. I will pay it back into their laps, both your sins and the sins of your father, says the Lord. Because they burned sacrifices on the mountains and defied me on the hills, I will measure into their laps the full payment for their former deeds. This is what the Lord says. As when juice is still found in a cluster of grapes, and men say, don't destroy it, there is yet some good in it. So will I do in behalf of my servants. I will not destroy them all. I will bring forth descendants from Jacob and from Judah, those who will possess my mountains. My chosen people will inherit them, and there will my servants live. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading is found in Galatians chapter 3, beginning with verse 23. Before this faith came, we were held prisoners by the law, locked up until faith should be revealed. So the law was put in charge to lead us to Christ that we might be justified by faith. Now that faith has come, we are no longer under the supervision of the law. You are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abram's seed and heirs according to the promise. What I am saying is that as long as the heir is a child, he is no different from a slave. Although he owns the whole estate, he's subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by his father. So also when we were children, we were in slavery under the basic principles of the world. But when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under law, that we might receive the full rights of sons. Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, God has made you also an heir. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel, according to St. Luke, the 8th chapter. They, Jesus and his disciples, sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torture me." For Jesus had commanded the evil spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "Legion," he replied, because many demons had gone into him, and they begged him repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. A large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. The demons begged Jesus to let them go into them, and he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed out the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When those tending the pigs saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in the town and countryside. And the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to see Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them because they were overcome with fear. So he got into the boat and left. The man whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return home and tell how much God has done for you." So the man went away and told over all the town how much Jesus had done for him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let's confess our Christian faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for the hymn, Rock of Ages, Clap for Me. Hymn number 761.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Where do you find your identity? Where do you find your hope? And what gets you going in the morning? There's all kinds of things that can make us driven. There's a to-do list of things that can get to be done for that day. And often this list of things involves family responsibilities. Going to work, paying the bills, and going on errands. Sometimes people have a dream that they strive for, especially with children. Many times they are asked, what do you want to be or do when you grow up? If they have an idea, then they can go to school or go into the workforce to live their dream. Being that today is Father's Day, I can see many fathers have once at least stopped and think about whether they have done a good job at being a father. Have they taken their kids to the right schools? Did they raise their kids in the right community? Did they have the right balance in being a loving father and yet also a father who disciplines? Some communities prefer not to discipline their children and let the children figure out on their own the rules that work for themselves. For example, there is one father who was excited about having a son. He was 17 years old at the time when he was going to be a father. He thought raising a child would be like having a new friend to enjoy life with. But little did he know, that was only half the story. One day, his 16-year-old son took his father's car for a ride without permission. And at this time, the boy hit a curb, sending a wheel on top of the hood of the neighbor's new Porsche. That night, the father must have been furious with his son, for he struggled to know if he had been too hard on him. Should he have had more empathy as he disciplined his son? But that's just the struggle, isn't it? If we look to the rules, we don't find comfort. And if we just look for comfort without the rules, then when does someone learn enough is enough? In our epistle lesson, the Apostle Paul lays out some of the challenges there are by just looking to the law for hope. If we look to the law for hope, we aren't going to find too much joy. Yes, there's a lot of things we can do right. We can often tell the truth. We can go to work and do the job that is asked of us. And we can thank others for serving us. But then, as we look back and ask ourselves, did I do a good job? Did I perfectly follow through everything I was supposed to? Oftentimes, the answer is, I could have done a better job. And this is the question that is often presented in a news story, isn't it? Could person so-and-so have done a better job? This question makes a person realize they don't have it all together. For Paul, the law isn't going to bring joy. Not civil law, where we fear the laws from our governing state, or the rules given by a family or any other community, nor will we even find joy in religious law. Not the law that was delivered by God through Moses, nor any form of law from any pagan religion. Yes, the law is good at teaching us to care for ourselves and to care for those around us. But because of our corrupt and sinful nature, the law does a better job at showing us our sin, how we are inadequate and set apart and distant from God. As Martin Luther once said as he was searching for his salvation, I hated the righteous God who punishes sinners. Perhaps this is one of the reasons why people don't like being a part of the church. For whatever reason, I'm sure they hear how they themselves are wrong and feel convicted and don't want to listen to God's word anymore. And by not listening, not only do they miss out on hearing how to care for themselves and their neighbors, but they also miss out on hearing on what Jesus has done for them and what he has done for all people. They miss out on receiving God's incredible blessing and gift. Apparently, in our epistle, the people in Galatia were looking for hope, but it was in the wrong places. They were looking for hope specifically in the religious law, the law they knew before they knew Jesus. Some once worshiped God through the law and instruction of the Old Testament. And some once worshiped many gods through whatever instruction that their pagan religion had to offer for them. And now that this group of people is coming together to worship in the name of Jesus Christ, the people from many different backgrounds and many different family and religious history, they are having to leave what they have known and followed for a long time. And the people just had a hard time figuring out just what is important. It isn't the job of the Gentiles to lead anyone to find hope in the pagan law, and nor was it the job of the Jews to make anyone follow the Jewish law or traditions. Paul says that the Old Testament law was to prepare the Jews to receive Jesus when he comes. And Jesus has indeed come. Neither group of people were to find their identity or common practice of worship, in sacrificing animals at the altars. For Jesus is the greatest and final sacrifice. The hope is in Jesus Christ, the one who completed God's law, the Old Testament law, for all people. Instead, the people ought to find their hope in word and sacrament ministry. It should be in hearing God's word and its saving promises found in Jesus Christ, along with celebrating the fact that they are baptized and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. And through Holy Communion, they receive Jesus Christ and continue to receive forgiveness of sins. In short, it's all about Jesus. It's about Jesus and what he has done for us. It's about this faith in Jesus Christ where through his work, we are saved. And this is our hope. This is our identity. And this is our future. Whatever happened in the past, from whatever we have done or family background that we come from, no longer matters. Doesn't matter if we are a Jew or a Gentile, or if we have a bad or troubling history. As we believe Jesus Christ, and as we have been baptized in his name, we belong to God's family. And this is what Martin Luther rediscovered in his studies as a monk. Through baptism, we are adopted into God's chosen people. Through baptism, we are children of Abraham, and we are members of God's family, and we receive Abraham's everlasting promises. Our inheritance is all the promises that was once given to Abraham and his family. And one of the promises is that God himself would send a perfect sacrifice to present to the Lord our God, so that God's wrath and punishment for all the things we have done wrong would be paid in full. And through this sacrifice, all of God's family is no longer guilty, but declared innocent. And this sacrifice is Jesus, the one who once was sacrificed for you and for me. He died for the times when we haven't followed through God's law that he's given us. He died for the times when we didn't love our neighbors as ourselves. And he died for the times when we have done an imperfect job. He died for the times when fathers could have been a better father. And he died for the times when someone has put a wheel into the hood of someone's new Porsche, so that the people can leave and turn from their sinful ways and come together and seek forgiveness. Forgiveness from others and forgiveness from God. As Jesus died in innocence and righteousness for you and for me, to clothe us in his righteousness, let us leave any guilt or burden from our past at the cross. For God's love, God our Father's love for us, is greater than our sins. He has given us baptism to bring us forgiveness of sins. He has given baptism to invite all people from every race, gender, religion, status, and age to have hope and faith in Jesus Christ, the one who, at the right time, fulfilled and followed all of the Old Testament law, so that we and all believers may receive God's eternal kingdom and our resurrected and renewed bodies, just as Jesus is alive and sitting at the right hand of God the Father in his resurrected body. In Jesus' name, amen. May the peace of God that transcends all understanding keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Now the song I have for offering it actually comes, you probably have heard it on the radio, but I looked at the words and I figured it was appropriate for Sunday worship, especially for Father's Day. And so the song about the son putting the wheel into the neighbor's Porsche, that was written by Aaron Baker, and George Strait ended up writing the song without love without end. Amen. We may now collect the offering.
I got sent home from school one day with a shiner on my eye. Fighting was against the rules and it didn't matter why. When Dad got home, I told that story just like I rehearsed. Then stood there on those trembling knees and waited for the worst. And he said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. He said, daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen. When I became a father in the spring of 81, there was no doubt that stubborn boy was just like my father's son. And when I thought my patience had been tested to the end, I took my daddy's secret and I passed it on to him. I said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. I said, daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end. Last night I dreamed I died and stood outside those pearly gates. When suddenly I realized there must be some mistake. If they know half the things I've done, they'll never let me in. And then somewhere from the other side, I heard these words again. And they said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. You see, daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen.
Let us stand. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O King of kings and Lord of lords, you call out to every nation of the earth seeking repentance and justice. Even as they rebel against your will, work repentance in all civil leaders and use them to defend the weak and to punish the guilty, that the church may continue to be free to preach the gospel. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, your Son sent the man formerly possessed by demons to declare how much God had done for him. May your church also, rescued from the snares of the devil, proclaim how much Jesus has done for us. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate Father, we give you thanks for earthly fathers. Give them confidence in their position and zeal for their task to care for their families faithfully. Have them be godly examples to their children and bless their work of bringing up children in the fear and instruction of the Lord. And give them the comfort of your love and forgiveness in all their shortcomings. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, your Son, Jesus, had pity on the man who was troubled with an abundance of demons. Have mercy on those who are now troubled in any way. Today, we especially lift up to you Paul Smees as we pray for a successful surgery from carpal tunnel. And we also lift up those to you who we now name silently in our hearts. Give them healing, strength, and an increase of faith. Lord, in your mercy. Dear Father, you know the condition of our souls. Hear our prayers and keep us strong in saving faith. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Before I give you the benediction, I realize I forgot two things for announcements. One of them, I think everyone kind of knows, but just a reminder, we still have the box up for the donations to get a screen in there. And again, that was about $40 a family or $30 a person if we wanted to reach our $700 goal of putting a new screen in there by donation. And then the other thing is, today's Father's Day, so make sure the fathers pick up a packet of trail mix for happy trails to you. And you can go home and enjoy a Roy Rogers. So with that, the Lord bless you and keep you. And the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.